In the peaceful solitude of the early hours of July 5th, 1955, a prototype of Britain's latest interceptor, the Gloster Javelin, soared through the starry skies over southern England. The aircraft had been specially designed to fly at night and in all weather conditions, but it was a Javelin in name alone. Not only did it travel at underwhelming speeds, but it was much bulkier than its contemporaries, with a large rounded fuselage, an enormous T-tail, and a broad triangular delta wing configuration, earning this odd-looking beast the nickname of the Flying Flatiron. It certainly caught a strange figure, as Wing Commander R.F. Dicky Martin guided it through the darkness at high altitude on a routine test flight. Calmly cruising just south of London, suddenly panic struck. As he struggled for breath, a cold sweat broke out across the pilot's forehead as he realized that his oxygen tube was stuck in his parachute harness. He desperately fought to untangle it. Then, out of nowhere, an earth-shattering boom broke the tranquility of the lonely night sky, waking households for miles around. Somehow, in the midst of his frantic attempt to free his oxygen tube, without even meaning to, Martin and his unwieldy Javelin had done the seemingly impossible. They had broken the sound barrier. The Gloster Javelin originated from a 1947 British Air Ministry request for a new high-performance night fighter, envisioned as part of a robust defense against the growing threat of jet-powered strategic bombers and atomic weaponry in the looming Cold War. Having been responsible for the Gloster Meteor, the only operational British jet aircraft of World War II, Gloster aircraft originally responded to the request with a modified version, known by the company designation of P-228. However, as specifications shifted over the course of the following 2 years, Gloster continued drawing up new designs, as did other manufacturers. While some of these were still very similar to the Meteor, others incorporated certain features that would later be seen on the Javelin, such as the delta wings and T-tail. Eventually, on April 13, 1949, the Ministry of Supply directed Gloster to build 4 operational prototypes of one particular design named the GA-5, as well as an airframe of the design for structural tests. The first GA-5 prototype, an unarmed model referred to as WD-804, made its maiden flight on November 26, 1951 at Morton Valence Airfield, flown by Gloster's chief test pilot, Squadron Leader W.A. Bill Waterton. While Waterton found the aircraft to be generally easy to fly, he was worried that its power controls may not be up to the task. When flying at high velocity, the WD-804 tended to buffet and flutter. On a test flight in June 1952, this proved to be a serious issue, so much so that both of the prototype's elevators were shaken off in midair. Though this could have had grave consequences for Waterton, fortunately, he was a highly skilled pilot and managed to get the aircraft back on the ground using tailplane trimming and engine thrust for pitch control. Though WD-804 was unable to be saved, Waterton miraculously escaped unharmed and was later awarded the George Medal for retrieving valuable flight data from the burning aircraft. A second unarmed prototype, known as WD-808, made its first flight in August of that year, with Waterton at the controls as before. However, it spent the remainder of 1952 on the ground, as Gloster's engineering team attempted to resolve the buffet and flutter issues. Testing resumed in 1953, with Peter Lawrence taking over as pilot, but in June of that year, the aircraft ran into trouble. In the middle of a flight, it experienced what's known as a deep stall. In other words, the wing had functioned as an air brake, halting forward movement and simultaneously disrupting the airflow over the elevators, rendering them ineffective. Without control of the elevators, Lawrence could not regain command of the aircraft, causing it to plummet from the sky. Lawrence ejected at around 400 feet, but it was too late. Tragically, neither he nor WD-808 survived. Throughout 1953 and 54, the third, fourth, and fifth prototypes were also completed. On July 22, 1954, just 2 days after the fifth prototype's maiden flight, test pilot R.F. Dicky Martin flew the first production model of the GA-5, now formally designated the Javelin Fighter All-Weather Mark I, abbreviated to FAW-1. The Javelin FAW-1 was the RAF's first purpose-built all-weather interceptor aircraft, though it had little in common with the slender spear after which it was named, being rather chunky and oddly proportioned. Other than the Flying Flatiron moniker, its unusual shape also earned it other nicknames, like the Flying Triangle and the Ace of Spades. Yet, while it may have had a somewhat ungainly appearance compared to its sleeker contemporaries, there was practical reasoning behind each design choice. Firstly, the Javelin's extra-wide fuselage allowed for a more spacious cockpit and provided more room for avionics and weapon systems. It was primarily constructed from aircraft aluminum alloys, with some steel fittings providing a strong, durable structure that could withstand the rigors of high-speed flight and adverse weather conditions, as well as helping enhance the aircraft's survivability in combat scenarios. In addition, the Javelin had massive delta wings, which had a wingspan of 52 feet and a total wing area of 927 square feet, the largest of any Western operational fighter to this day, with only the Soviet Tu-128 having a more sizable wing. These were designed to increase lift and decrease drag, and were equipped with hydraulically actuated flaps and ailerons to improve maneuverability and allow for greater load handling. What's more, each wing had slotted spoiler-type air brakes on both the top and bottom, which were infinitely variable, as well as being highly responsive and effective, enabling pilots to execute rapid descents and intense braking maneuvers, which facilitated quick landings. Initially, early prototypes featured a straight sweep of 39.5 degrees at 25% chord, but a kinked wing design was introduced during development. This configuration maintained the original sweep on the inner part of the wing, while reducing the sweep to 33.8 degrees on the outer portion, leading to broader wingtips and improved stall characteristics. Adding to the Javelin's unusual appearance was its high T-tail. Its tail fin had a sweep of 47.6 degrees at 25% chord, while the triangular tailplane was swept at 42.8 degrees at the same chord. This design kept the tail surfaces clear of the jet exhaust and wing wake, improving control at high angles of attack and during low-speed maneuvers, as well as contributing to better aerodynamic performance and stability at high speeds. Both the rudder and elevators were hydraulically operated, and the entire tailplane could adjust its incidence electrically, primarily during takeoffs and landings. The Javelin was equipped with hydraulically actuated tricycle landing gear, each with a single wheel. The nose gear retracted backward, and the main gear folded inward from the wings toward the fuselage. The FAW-1 model included 5 fuel tanks in each wing and 2 in the forward fuselage, totaling 12 internal tanks. Having flown the Javelin prototypes during its development, U.S. Air Force pilots had raised concerns about the aircraft's limited endurance. As a response, dual flush-mounted belly tanks were introduced, each with a capacity of 1,137 liters, or 300 U.S. gallons. With a brassiere-like shape, these tanks were colloquially known as bosom tanks, or Sabrinas, the latter a reference to a famously well-endowed British pin-up girl and starlet of the time. The pilot and radar operator were seated in a tandem configuration within an air-conditioned cockpit, shielded by a 4-piece canopy designed for optimal visibility. The rear portion of the canopy moved back over the fuselage, allowing the radar operator to enter, while the second segment slid back from the windscreen over a fixed third segment to give the pilot access. Initially, prototypes utilized a different canopy design with a solid metal rear cover equipped with small portholes on each side, aimed to improve the radar operator's visibility of the radar scope. However, it was later decided that having an additional visual lookout was advantageous, leading to a redesign. Unlike the Gloster Meteor, the Javelin came with ejection seats. The Martin Baker seats required careful measurement of the radar operator's leg length from knee to hip. If their thighs were too long, there was a risk of his kneecaps being cut off by the radar display during ejection. The aircraft was powered by twin non-afterburning Armstrong Siddeley Sapphire Mark VI turbojet engines, each delivering a thrust of 36.9 kilonewtons, though many pilots reported that it was even easy to fly with just one engine. Initially, designers considered using Rolls-Royce Avon engines, but they lacked sufficient power. The engine inlets were notably wide-set, yet the engines themselves were angled towards each other to minimize thrust asymmetry in the event of an engine failure. A small pointed pen-nib fairing was situated between the exhausts to alleviate buffeting issues noted in early production models. The engines were started using pyrotechnic starters, which involved inserting what resembled a large shotgun shell into a port and igniting it to generate gas that started the engine, typically accompanied by a burst of black smoke. If the engines failed to start on the first attempt and became flooded, a successful second attempt would dramatically eject a large flame from the exhausts. Although this was an impressive sight, it was completely harmless. The FAW-1 was equipped with airborne intercept Mark 17 radar and sported 4 30mm Auden revolver cannons, with 2 cannons installed in each wing. Early prototypes featured a rounded nose radome. However, this proved highly susceptible to erosion and was swiftly substituted with a more durable pointed radome. Initially, the aircraft was to be armed with 2 Auden cannons and 2 4.5-inch recoilless guns. While the RAF showed initial enthusiasm for the larger recoilless guns, this interest was short-lived, as focus shifted towards guided air-to-air missiles, or AAMs. Although it was anticipated from the beginning that the Javelin would be outfitted with AAMs, The pace of aircraft development exceeded that of missile technology, leading the FAW-1 to rely primarily on its four cannons for armament. Throughout its service, the Javelin maintained a standard camouflage of dark sea green and dark sea gray on its upper surfaces, with medium sea gray below. Test models of the Javelin, however, were often painted in striking high-visibility colors for trial purposes. With the production model now in the air, it would undergo an extended period of further testing. However, as with the prototypes, this did not always go smoothly, with pilots frequently involved in accidents. In December 1955, one test pilot experienced a flat spin at 40,000 feet during a maneuver to test the Javelin's buffet boundaries. The aircraft's anti-spin parachute failed to correct the spin, prompting him to eject at 8,000 feet. In response to this incident, a stall warning device was subsequently created for the aircraft, one of many upgrades developed over the second half of the 1950s and into the early 1960s, which resulted in FAWs 2-9. Meanwhile, Bill Waterton, the test pilot of the Javelin's first prototype, had become a vocal critic of the aircraft. His constant complaints had seen him fired from Gloster, and he had now taken to publicly attacking it in his new role as a newspaper correspondent. Apart from the Javelin safety issues, Waterton and other voices in the media also focused on its lackluster speed, which had so far topped out at around 715 miles per hour, or Mach 0.94, significantly slower than many similar aircraft of its day. Therefore, it came as a great shock when Wing Commander R.F. Dicky Martin unintentionally flew a Javelin at the speed of sound on a test flight shortly after midnight on July 5, 1955, provoking a loud sonic boom that was heard all over South London and many of the surrounding counties, leading to several local police forces becoming inundated with phone calls from concerned citizens who'd been woken up by the bang. However, it was a feat that proved impossible to repeat, a freak one-off. 19 different RAF squadrons flew the Javelin at some point or other. Javelins based in Cyprus often operated under high-stress conditions, intercepting Turkish aircraft that entered Cypriot airspace. They also occasionally intercepted Egyptian aircraft on similar missions and escorted Soviet bombers and patrol planes traversing the eastern Mediterranean. Starting in 1963, as tensions escalated between Malaya and Indonesia, Javelins stationed in Singapore were sent to Malaya for border patrols. In late 1965, after Rhodesia declared independence from Britain, 10 Javelin FAW-9Rs from Cyprus were deployed to Zambia. They flew south, carrying 6 external fuel tanks each, prompting complaints from the Egyptian government when they crossed Egyptian airspace without authorization. The deployment extended into 1966. The conditions were challenging, with one Javelin losing a fire-streak missile after termites infiltrated the landing gear and consumed the missile's solid propellers. Despite their active deployment, no Javelin ever actually engaged in battle. While it seems it would have made an effective interceptor in a combat situation, its large wings giving it plenty of lift, and its well-designed air brakes enabling pilots to rapidly slow down should they need to gain an advantage over pursuing enemy aircraft, it was soon cast aside in favor of the English Electric Lightning. With its unique vertically stacked engines, the new interceptor was capable of reaching Mach 2 speeds, making it over twice as fast as the Javelin. The last frontline Javelin squadrons in Britain were phased out by 1964 as more Lightnings became operational, though the Javelin continued to serve in lesser roles and in overseas bases for a few more years. The last Javelin squadron was disbanded in Singapore in 1968, while one lone Javelin continued to fly with the Royal Aircraft Establishment until 1976. While the Javelin never made a big impact as an interceptor, some have suggested that its service life could have been longer had it been adapted for a missile truck role, with more advanced radar and missiles, shifting its focus from speed and agility onto payload. Although this is certainly an interesting speculation, it shall remain just that. Despite its relatively short-lived career, the Gloster Javelin's legacy lives on, thanks to several museums and collections around the world that display the aircraft today.